It doesn't matter if you love dancing or not. It's not only about dancing. It's all about just the experience and the life as it is, the life that I'm living, the originality of being a human being, the originality of being just existing, you know?
Marilyn Boylebase says, "Thick charity is grounded in unconditional love, profound compassion, or humanistic regard for others. Thick charity is a reaching out to fellow humans in times of their distress. It is not throwing money at a problem to save one's conscience, or to hope that the problem will go away. In learning service, students should ponder thick aims and ends for charitable work."
Dunsfold started in 1990, and it has changed a lot of people's lives. We have so many successful stories of kids that come from nothing.
Philip Boyd, a former principal dancer with the Cape Town City Ballet, started Township Ballet classes in 1991, beginning with 34 students in a school classroom in Guguletu under the name Ballet for All. 4 years later, when the program expanded to include diverse dance styles, the organization was renamed Dance for All. Since its creation in 1991, DFA has been giving its students the chance to reach beyond their circumstances by teaching skills that open doors to a career in the performing arts. Their training provides them with a strong foundation in the disciplines of ballet, African, and contemporary dance, which gives them the versatility needed to succeed in the profession. However, the life skills that underpin their training, such as discipline, focus, and self-confidence, give DFA students an advantage no matter what they choose to do. Initially, renowned prima ballerina Phyllis Spira, Philip's wife, was involved in a supportive role. When she retired from the stage, she joined DFA as assistant artistic director and, until her death in 2008, helped to build the organization into the highly regarded school of dance it is today.
The main goal in general at Dance for All is to help facilitate the bridging from amateur to professional dancers in previously disadvantaged communities.
Discipline that we instill in them, that we take them wherever they go.
Most of DFA's students live in very challenging circumstances, where poverty and unemployment are rife, and social ills such as gangsterism and substance abuse are common. By providing an enjoyable and constructive extramural activity that is open to all, DFA gives children the opportunity to spend their afternoons off the street in a safe and stimulating environment.
To give them hope that there is hope, that there is something to do, there's something to create, something for yourself, become someone, and even to contribute to the country by giving out, by dancing, by singing, by teaching, whatever.
Dance changes you as a person. That never personally dance, but I've seen the changes here.
As a volunteer at DFA, I got to see what goes on behind the scenes and try my hand at everything from admin work to teaching. This is the wardrobe, my home base. DFA is constantly receiving donations of new and used dance costumes and shoes. As you can see, the wardrobe is pretty enormous. It requires constant upkeep so that everything is always in its place. Although it seems messy, there's actually a very calculated order in here. So one of my roles as a volunteer was trying to keep it that way. This is the teacher's lounge. Another one of my responsibilities was to work on fundraising projects. Bridget and Tina, the two fundraising gurus at DFA, showed me the ropes of how to apply for funding from different organizations through corporate social responsibility programs. I also used this space to update a directory of contact info for schools in the Western Cape and to email out digital flyers for the upcoming show. I also got the chance to take a few dance classes myself with the Bridging Program. The Bridging Program is DFA's pre-professional group. It was exciting to compare and contrast the way dance is taught here with my previous experience. I also enjoyed getting to know the bridging students a little bit over the course of my time at DFA. My favorite responsibility by far was teaching in the outreach program. On Wednesday and Thursday afternoons, I accompanied my fellow teacher and friend, Eba, to teach classes in Khayelitsha, Delft, and Claremont. Sometimes I would assist him in working with large classes, and often I was able to lead my own classes in ballet. At first, I struggled with the somewhat scattered nature of my job. At Stanford, it's easy to get caught up in the business of marketing our experiences, and I didn't see how performing this set of unrelated tasks for 7 weeks would make any sense as a cohesive whole. But I began to realize that although I was not taking on big projects or learning any notable skills, I was learning how to let go of my ego. Once I stopped caring about how my experience at DFA would look on paper, I realized that the soft skills I was gaining were equally important. I decided once and for all to relinquish my ego, instead immersing myself in whatever tasks were needed from day to day. I may not have moved any mountains at DFA, but I did get some much-needed practice in being a supportive team player as opposed to an assertive leader. Ronald Barnett argues in favor of developing one's soft skills in his essay, Learning for an Unknown Future. He says, "Learning for an unknown future cannot be accomplished by the acquisition of either knowledge or skills. There is always an epistemological gap between what is known and the exigencies of the moment as it invites responses, and this is particularly so in a changing world. Analogously, skills cannot be expected to carry one far in a changing environment. There can be no assurance that skills appropriate to situations of the past or even the present will help one to engage with the future world in a meaningful way." My experience at DFA has been enriched by the stories of the people I've met along the way. Each person's background is different, but teachers, administrators, and volunteers alike are united by a passion for dance and an even stronger passion and love for their students.
But you know, when you go out and teach those kids, you forget everything. You forget about the negativity that you had. You know, seeing those kids, you know, those eyes that are, you know, the hunger that is there in them.
Okay, the most thing that makes me excited to come to work every day is just because I know I'm making a big impact to the kids, and I've changed so many children's attitude and mindset. And I've actually given hope and encouraged them, which makes me proud of what I'm doing, proud of what I'm doing for the organization.
It's like, almost like, even though, like, especially the older ones, even though I'm basically their age, I do feel like an aunt, like when I watch them on stage, when I watch them perform. You know, it's like really like, I feel so proud of them.
But the first class was very difficult because, you know, not something that you used to. Music was too soft, you know, classical music, it was boring. Our teacher kept saying that, you know, pull the tummy in, the bottom in, and long neck, so I couldn't hold it all together. So I had a very difficult first class because I wasn't breathing. And I thought to myself, yay, I'm going to die here.
It's been a long way for me, but it was not easy from the beginning because of family not understanding also, but I really had to make them understand, even though they didn't want to understand. But it's not that they didn't want to understand, they were never introduced to such style of dance, that a black male dancer can be doing such a kind of dancing.
I don't know that what I've done at DFA would be considered service by many. I didn't build any schools or churches, I didn't teach any kids how to speak English, and I didn't alleviate poverty or hunger. To be honest, I'm not entirely sure that I consider it service either. But I've learned to question the validity and worth of service in the traditional sense of the word. Rather, I have come to learn the importance of service learning by means of forging human connection. Lori Pompa encourages dialogue between those involved in service learning environments. She says, "This dialogue certainly includes the spoken word, through which participants share ideas, stories, perceptions, opinions, verbalizing realities with and for one another. More fundamentally, though, it is an experience through which people speak their lives, by the simple yet profound act of being together." It has truly been a privilege to share stories, coffee, bus rides, hardship, and laughter with the people I've met at Dance for All this quarter. I will treasure and remember these relationships as I return to the States, and I hope that someday I will be able to pay forward this invaluable and precious experience of learning service.